Are you in the market for a new Luckin amplifier? This video will help you make a smart choice. I'm Kvanch, application scientist at Zurich Instruments. An excellent starting point when deciding on a Luckin amplifier is the instrument's input frequency range, as it needs to be wide enough to capture the signal of interest. However, it's not just the upper frequency limit. Depending on your application, low frequencies and even DC might be relevant too. Now, let's take a look at the instrument's input noise. It needs to be low to measure small signals with a high signal-to-noise ratio. The manufacturers characterize the voltage noise density versus frequency. It can be as low as 2.5 nanovolts per square root hertz, as in this example. Below the corner frequency, the voltage noise density scales typically as the inverse of frequency. For best results, you should consider an instrument with a corner frequency lower than your target frequency and a low and flat noise floor to minimize the disturbances in your measurement. And most important, ensure the input noise data covers the entire input frequency range to avoid unpleasant surprises. Another key parameter to consider is the Luckin amplifier's dynamic reserve, which quantifies the instrument's capability to withstand disturbing signals and noise while maintaining a certain measurement accuracy, usually 1%. For example, with a 120 dB dynamic reserve, you can measure a signal of 1 microvolt with a 1% accuracy in the presence of 1 volt disturbance. Keep in mind that different manufacturers may define the dynamic reserve differently, which makes a one-to-one comparison more difficult. The central element of a Luckin amplifier is the variable low-pass filter. Its specifications are the filter bandwidth, or time constant, and the filter order. Depending on your application, you might need a broad filter bandwidth with a short time constant for fast measurements, or a very narrow filter bandwidth to recover signals buried in noise with time constants longer than a few seconds. If spurious noise is nearby in frequency, a high filter order with a steep filter slope helps reject it. So, ensure that the instrument offers multiple filter orders and a broad filter bandwidth range for your current and future needs. But it's not just about specifications. An intuitive and capable user interface is equally important. It enables you to adjust all Luckin amplifier settings easily and capture the data directly in the format you want, and therefore avoids frustration in the lab. Also, it provides direct control of all additional tools included in modern Luckin amplifiers, such as an oscilloscope, spectrum analyzer, and parametric sweeper. Employing those tools in parallel can help you gain a more thorough understanding of the signals in your experiment. Do you want to automate the measurement and integrate it into your setup in the lab? Whatever is your favorite programming language, pick an instrument that supports it out of the box. Finally, consider your entire setup. If you need real-time analog output or synchronization with other devices, make sure to have enough auxiliary and trigger channels. If you need to measure multiple frequencies simultaneously or implement an additional feedback loop, choose an instrument that offers this functionality, such as multiple Luckin units, PID controllers and PLLs, boxcar averagers, pulse counters, and arbitrary waveform generators. Often, those can be added when the need arises. An instrument that can run all of them in parallel helps you simplify your setup and save you a lot of time and money, instead of stacking several devices on your shelf. There you have it. These 6 aspects will help you choose a Luckin amplifier that best matches your requirements and costs you the least in time and effort. If you need any advice, get in touch. We can help. Thanks for watching.